Come with me on the tasty trail with Benjamin.
Wonderful today. Look at that. Look at that. Today it's minus more than 15, so maybe minus 20, something like that. Really cold, but you see we have a bright sun. So it's a beautiful day, and I'm sure I'm going to enjoy the snow. The snow seems to be very nice too.
Hey.
Benjamin, I'm with you on the Tasty Trail, and this time you see we are in a ski resort in the Gangwon province, and we are going to make you discover something very important in Korean cuisine, which is the jang, and especially the doenjang, which is the soy bean paste. So let's go and discover all the bean cuisine in Korea. Look at what I have in front of me. That's absolutely wonderful. The lady here prepared for us this wonderful table. And that's a way for us to, discover directly, experience directly the food made with the jang. So here we have different jang. So of course you recognize here the doenjang jjigae, the stew or soup made with the fermented bean paste. That's one that you can find on almost every table, almost every day in Korean diet. So that's a classic one. I'm going to pour some of the soup in the bibimbap. So some of the soup in the bibimbap, that would make something even softer, and if it's already possible, even better. Ginger mash is really good. It's absolutely delicious. What you can do is, like, you know, like Korean people, they love the sam. I think I already mentioned the sam culture in Korea, like wrapping the food in seaweed, in sesame leaves, or in salad, whatever. So that's the way to eat usually the grilled meat in Korea. So I'm doing it this way, but it's so delicious that you could eat the meat by itself. As we do in France, you know. Delicious. Delicious. I don't know where to start, you know, like this or this or this all together. That's good also. But there are much more than dishes than that with the doenjang. That's the basic one, the more famous. But you have a lot actually of dishes or side dishes based on doenjang. Wow! The soy beans are from a plant which is actually probably from the northern part of China and Manchuria. So it means we have had these soybeans for a long, long time in Korea. The technique of all the fermented products may have come from China, but Korean people made their own recipes with the time. Now we are going to bring the beans to the mortar over there, which is called cholgu. Okay, so we should do it when it's still warm. Okay. So here is the traditional mortar called the cholgu in Korean. A wooden mortar used to grind the beans for the doenjang, and especially to do what we call the mechu, and I'm going to explain later about the mechu. So now we are making the mechu. So what is a mechu? Mechu, you have one just in front of you. This is the block of the beans which have been boiled, ground, and then, as you see, pressed in a mold to give them the shape of the block. Okay, so I'm going to do like our host. I'm going to go on it, but I'm so fat that I hope I won't break the mold. 내가 너무 무거워서 틀 터질 것 같은데. 그렇죠? Indeed, she says. All right, 봅시다. Let's have a look. Oh, not bad. You need absolutely around the mechu some rice straw rope. It's not for the decoration that we burn that. It's not only to hang them, to dry them. It's because we need the straw to get the fungus to appear. And that's the secret, I would say, of the mechu. Without the straw, it doesn't work. That's the final result. And you see this mold, the fungus everywhere. You have to clean it with a brush. Let it outside a little bit to a final drying in the sunlight. And then it's ready for the next step. And that's what I'm going to show you. So now it's time to put in the big jar with the brine. You know, we have prepared the brine, the salt, salted water. It's time to put the mechu, the block, which has been kept for a few months inside, breathing, and clean a little bit, and dried in the sunlight before putting it in the water. We are going to put also some jujube, Korean date, the techu. And, very important, warm charcoal, because it's a smell absorbent. All right. So it's to clean, to absorb. And after, we can leave this brine with the mechu and all the stuff for a few weeks and even few months if you want to make a special kind of soy sauce. And after, we take this out. We take the mechu out to have the doenjang and the kanjang, the soybean paste on the side, and what is left over is the soy sauce. Here, these are the ones for the doenjang or fermented bean paste. Why? Why do we use this in Korea? Well, there is a reason. It's because this is made with a clay, earthenware, and it has a special property. It breathes, you know. The dog is wonderful because it allows the food inside to breathe and to, you know, to have a good ventilation and then a good fermentation, because all these products are based on fermentation.
Incredible, the deep valley. It's really beautiful here. For me, it's one of the most beautiful places in Korea. It's kind of remote area. It's really wild in a way. It's really beautiful.
Here we are in one of my favorite places in Korea called Cheongsun, a very nice small town in the Gangwon province. And we are here for a special day, which is Oiljang, or the market, which is held every 5 days. A very traditional market which has been here for 300 years. We are going to see a lot of different stuff from the mountain and from the area of the Gangwon province. Come with me. Over there we have some beans, especially the peanuts, some corn. You know that Gangwon province is famous for the corn. You have here the oksusu in Korean, the small yellow and red one, very cute. It's more for decoration, I guess. Wow. Oh, that's a nice, interesting place. It's the place for the jangachi, the Korean pickles, mashito. Very good, she says. Well, you know, here we are in front of the jangachi shop. Jangachi is something very important in Korean diet. Most of them are cooked with soy sauce. Soy sauce, adding a little bit of vinegar and sugar. But you have other ways to do the jangachi. For example, you can use only salt, like a brine. You can use only doenjang, you know, the bean paste, fermented bean paste. You can use also gochujang, which is the red hot chili pepper paste. What else? Some stuff is kept in sugar, but it's not very common. The most common being, as I said, soy sauce, doenjang, bean paste, or the gochujang. It's one of the most important dishes of Korean diet. It's what we call a meat banchan. What is meat banchan? It's a banchan that you can keep for a long time. So jangachi is one of the meat banchan, and the bean banchan is one of the most important elements of the Korean table. I almost forgot why I came to this market. It's because of the beans. You know, we came here to look at the beans because we are doing the bean paste or the doenjang. So here we are. This is bean paradise. We have a lot of different things here. Let's go to the hero of the day, which is the what we call in Korean kong or baekdae, which is the soy bean. The scientific name is Glycinemax. It's not the family of the beans we know from South America, which are phesolus. Over there, you have a phesolus. These ones come from South America. They were completely absent of the old world until the discovery of America. But the ones that we found in Asia, and actually they are from maybe originally from Manchuria, are these ones. So the white bean, which is used to make the doenjang or the fermenting bean paste, and this one is the same, except that it is black. Huk te, bek te. Bek for white and huk for black. And here we have one which is very typical of the area. It's called chwinuni kong, which is in Korean meaning a bean which has the shape of a mouse eye. It's very poetic. The kong in Korean, or a more official name being bekte, which is the soy beans. You see the size, you see the color. That's what is at the center of the ASEAN diet, actually. Not only Korea, but also Japan and China, of course. Because in this one, it's actually the most proteinous vegetable in the world. You have a lot of proteins inside of it. So that's absolutely necessary to the Korean diet, because since people don't eat so much meat or fish, even if they do more and more, of course, but basically they need proteins, and especially in winter time, they find it in all the food derived from the beans, the soybeans. This is the puok, the kitchen, a traditional kitchen. It's quite interesting because you can see here this place. You have the agungi, which is at the same time the fireplace and also the stove. You can see here the iron cauldron where the rice or the soups were prepared. And you see below, you have the place to put the wood to make the fire, which is going to heat the cauldrons, but also to heat the heating system of the house called the ondol. So this is a very clever system, and this is the place where the food was made as well by the women. So you see it's almost open to the outside. It's half inside, half outside. It's warmed only by this this place. Here you have the metol. The metol, it's also a kind of mortar used to grind this time the beans for the dubu or tofu, the bean curd. That's the main maybe elements of this kitchen. In front of us we have these wonderful banchan or side dishes, which are going to come and complement the rice with some spice and some different flavors and textures. And here we have the doenjang jjigae or doenjang guk, which is the soup. And more than a soup, it is the Korean soup, the soup with the fermented soybean paste. It's a pungent flavor. It's not spicy. I mean, a little bit, but just enough. It's a very rich and complex taste. No, if you are accustomed to the European stews, winter stews, you won't be surprised, and you cannot help but loving this doenjang jjigae. Otoke iruke maisseo. Jinja maisseo. Majitale. I've had in Korea thousands of doenjang jjigae, but this one is really killing me. 근데 이거는 어떻게 왜 이렇게 맛있어요? 진짜로 doenjang 때문이죠.
그렇죠.
Yeah, it's because of the doenjang. And the doenjang in this place is very special because it's made with the chwinuni kong. You remember the small black, bluish black beans. So it's even more special. Here we have the jjongguk, the base of this soup. So once again, it's soybeans which have been boiled and let to ferment, and allow a fungus to grow on them, making it, like you see, a little bit like sticky and funky. Similar, maybe you know it, the Japanese natto. A little bit similar to that, except that in Japan we eat it like this, like, you know, almost like a side dish on top of the rice. In Korea it's more like a sauce or a stew. And wow, that's strong, it's good. And they mix it with a little bit of chili pepper as well. Wow. So that's the place to make the jjongguk jang. They have been boiling these beans for 4 hours. And you see the color, the dark color, it's because they use in this place the beans we have seen in the market called the chinuni kong, the beans which look like mouse eyes. And that's what they are going to do. So we are going to go together inside because they have a special place for the jjongguk jang to grow. Because to make the jjongguk jang, you have to have a special equipment, a room like this one, which is at the same temperature. It's 29 degrees, so quite warm. You see, they have straw, rice straw, on which they put a cloth, on which they pour the boiled beans. And they are going to leave them at the same temperature. And that's the place where, because of the heat, is going to grow on top of the beans the fungus. The fungus which is going to give the jjongguk jang itself the taste because of the fermentation. And you know, the stickiness of the jjongguk jang and the strong smell, the pungent smell and flavor comes from this fermentation caused by the fungus which is growing in the heat and moisture of this room. Okay, so I guess you see it's not a very complicated process as long as you have the way to keep the temperature equal for 2 days. First, it's good. The other reason is that it's an incredibly healthy food. Actually, what is sure is that it has a lot of effects on preventing high blood pressure, heart disease, and all the problem with your arteria. And some people say that it has also some detox effect, especially on people who smoke or drink too much. On a regular basis, of course, it can have wonderful effects on you. And I'm going to work on that. I wish we could find more often this kind of taste in Seoul. It's a sad, very sad moment. No more rice. It's the end of the meal. It was so good. I think I may ask another rice. Jang is the source of all flavors. If the taste of a house's jang is not good, even if there are good vegetables or flavorful meats, one cannot prepare good food. This is a quotation from an old 19th century Korean cookbook, and it shows the importance of the jang in Korean cuisine. You understood, I guess, that this jang or soybean products are not only good, but also very healthy. And they are, you understood as well, the center of the Korean diet. So I see you next week for another episode of our Tasty Trail with Benjamin in Korea. Bye. This one is a wild mulberry tree from the mountain. And this one is ta-da!
Oh, man!
You okay?